So, Vidyamala, can you tell me, do you think everyone experiences the worldly winds of pleasure and pain?
Yes. I think one of the wrong views we can have about the spiritual life is that an enlightened person or a Buddha never experiences pain. So you just have this lovely, happy, perfectly pain-free existence. But what's clear from the sutta is that the Buddha did experience physical pain when he was an old man. There's an image of his body being like a cart tied together with straps, which is a very evocative image. So the distinction, as I understand it, between an unwise person, or as the sutta calls it, an uninstructed run-of-the-mill person, and a wise disciple of the noble ones, or someone who's got insight, the distinction is how we respond to pain and pleasure. So that's the key point here. Everybody experiences the winds, they blow around, of pain and pleasure, everybody in this world. But an enlightened being has a completely liberated response to the worldly winds of pain and pleasure.
So instead of an unwise person, how would they respond?
An unwise person, how would they respond? Well, of course, we're very familiar with that, aren't we? That's myself, that's other people. So what an unaware, unwise person does is we have an automatic reaction to pain and pleasure. So pain comes along, an unpleasant sensation in the body perhaps, an unpleasant thought, unpleasant emotion, and before we know it, we've gone, I don't want that, and we've pushed it away, we've resisted it and resented it. There's another sutta called the Sutta of the Dart, the Salatha Sutta, where the Buddha talks about pain being like an arrow being pierced by an arrow. And then the unwise person resists and resents that arrow. And then it's as if you're pierced by another arrow. So you have one arrow, which is the pain. And then because you're unwise, unaware, it's as if you've got another arrow coming in. And of course, in my experience and what I observe around me, it's not just one arrow, it's dozens of arrows coming. It's like a volley of arrows coming in because of our unaware reactivity to pain. And just to stay with pain for a moment, you might think, well, how does that manifest? And I think we can look at that on different levels. So the mental second arrow of resisting and resenting will be thoughts like, say, if you've got physical pain, be thoughts like, oh no, I can't bear it, it's not fair, it's going to ruin my day, it's going to ruin my life, poor me, woe is me, etc. Second darts of emotional pain is things like anxiety, fear, depression, anger, all those kind of toxic emotions that we can have. Just because we don't like pain, we get all these other emotions that arise quite automatically. And then second arrow physical experience is secondary tension. So you have something you don't like that's uncomfortable in the body. You're unaware and you tense against it, and you just make the pain worse through your unaware reaction. The good news is, and we'll come on to this in a minute, that the secondary stuff we can do something about. We can completely overcome and reduce the second arrows. So that's really brilliant. We'll come on to that in a minute. And how does the unwise person deal with the worldly wind of pleasure? Yeah. So pleasure comes along into your life, you see something that you like, you desire it, and before you know it, you've gone, ah, I want more of that. So you're not actually enjoying it, because while the pleasure's there, you're already thinking about, oh, I want it to last, I want more of this, and you're frightened that it will fade away and pass. So you sort of destroy the ability to actually enjoy it through this grasping, craving mind. So basically, the unwise person, as I understand it and experience it, it's a bit as if we're kind of crucifying ourselves with these twin poles of pushing away the unwanted and longing for the pleasant. So you're going through your life strung out between this aversive response on the one hand and this I want more of it response on the other.
So then, coming to the wise person, how do they respond then?
Okay, so this is the nub of the discussion. Well, Vajragupta, in his little book on the worldly wind, which I think is an excellent book, he says that the Dharma door of the worldly winds of pleasure and pain is mindfulness. And I must say, I absolutely agree with that. That the key to avoiding these second reactive arrows, either in the case of pleasure or pain, is to be aware, to wake up and to know, well, what is actually happening right now? You know, right now, what is my experience in my body? What am I thinking? What are my emotions? And I'd just like to say at this point that when I use the word mindfulness, I'm implicit in that is kindliness and tenderness, emotional engagement. So I believe a wise person is mindful and heartful of their actual moment-by-moment experience. So they can pause and insert a little bit of space into this kind of reactive behaviour and make choices about how they respond to these worldly winds that are just going to blow and blow, because we have a body, we live in this world.
Are there steps to move from experiencing pain to experiencing actual pleasure without craving it?
Okay, So I see it as a number of steps that we can take to move from being trapped in this kind of contracted, reactive state to a state where we're moving up the spiral path, where we're open, present, awake, and we're allowing positive emotion to build and build and build and to become more and more open and expansive. So I think the very first step, perhaps obviously, is simply to become aware in a broad and general sense, just to kind of come to from our unaware fog of being lost in reactivity. And then perhaps paradoxically and surprisingly, I would say the next thing we need to do is to turn towards the unpleasant. I think nobody likes to suffer. So many of us are driven by trying to escape the unpleasant. But that's the kind of drive beneath a lot of our behaviour. You know, whatever that unpleasant might be, it might be physical pain, emotional pain, mental pain, or perhaps existential pain, just a sense of inner emptiness, my life doesn't feel quite right. So I think the place to start for many of us is to turn towards what is unwanted in my experience right now. And I think the way to do that is to drop into the body, feel the weight of the body, the shape of the body, pay attention to the breath. This is very interesting, because when we're resisting something that we don't like, we will be holding the breath to some degree or other. If you make a little fist right now, what's happened to the breath? Many of us are fine, we've automatically held the breath. So that little fist is a metaphor for all the kinds of resistances we have in our daily life. So not only do we have resistance, but we have held breath. So I think the first thing to do is drop into the body, drop into the breath, soften the breath, feel the breath, let the body breathe. And the Buddha mentions in the Salatha Sutta and the Sutta on the Worldly Winds that it's resistance that's the problem. It's not the pain that's the problem. It's the resistance and the resentment that's the problem. So drop into the body, drop into the breath, and turn towards, scan through your experience and turn towards resistance that is present. And usually that's felt as a quality of contraction. You know, you don't need to worry too much about where it's come from, but just where in your experience do you feel tight and contracted? And then soften into that. Use the breath to soften into that experience and begin to drop into the changing nature of experience. And of course this is very key to the worldly winds, that the wise one sees how the worldly winds are inconstant and always changing. So that's the insight aspect. So drop into your experience and notice the way this resistance, this tight knot of I don't like this, is actually, you know, it's a flow of experiences arising, passing away moment by moment. So an image which I like, which I find very helpful, is I imagine when I'm doing this, I'm just leaning very, very gently against a bale of hay. Because a bale of hay looks solid, but as you lean against it, it yields a little bit. It just gives a little bit. So I try to have that kind of quality with whatever it is that's tight in my body. Just this yielding, soft, tender, gentle quality. And I try to be kind towards whatever it is that's unpleasant. To perhaps treat that as I would naturally treat a loved one that was suffering, that had this experience. So that's the next. And the first thing is basic awareness, and then the next step is turn towards the unpleasant, soften around it, bring tenderness to it, bring acceptance towards it, and see into its changing nature. Allow it to arise, allow it to pass away. So on the basis of having turned towards the unpleasant, what you will also have done is awoken sensitivity in yourself. because while we're blocked and resistant, we'll be blocking out a whole band of sensitivity, and that includes the ability to appreciate the pleasant. Maybe you've had this experience where you're a bit blocked against pain. You don't feel the pain so much. And then you see a beautiful sunset and you don't feel anything. Or you hear beautiful music and you don't hear anything. Because you've become a bit numb to everything. So now that we've sort of awoken the heart towards the unpleasant, we turn towards seeking out the pleasant in our actual moment-by-moment experience. And I think it's important not to think it needs to be really big and grand. It might be something really subtle, like a soft heart. I mean, I often feel a soft heart at this point because it's such a relief to stop blocking and resisting. It's kind of, oh, here I am, I'm human. It's a relief to stop fighting my life. It might be a soft face. In meditation, you think, oh, my face is really soft. I've noticed in meditation that my eyelids touching is very pleasant. I never used to notice that sort of thing. It might be birds outside the window. So you begin to notice that there's many, many things in each moment. There's not just the unwanted that you're pushing away. Yes, that is there. But then there's also all these other aspects. So you spend some time. I often say it's like being an explorer looking for buried treasure. Sort of searching around in your actual experience for pleasant feelings. And I think it's good to stay in the body. So you stay present and grounded. So these two steps, it's a little like we've had a close-up lens on a camera. We've looked at the unpleasant, we've looked at the pleasant, and now it's like we pull back to a wide-angle lens on the same experience, and we allow the unpleasant to arise and pass away without resistance, and we allow the pleasant to arise and pass away without clinging. So we're dropping back, if you like, into a very broad, open field of awareness, very mindful, kindly, warm, and you just let everything arise and pass away, and you're no longer tipping into either aversion or clinging. And Anālio, in his book on the Satipatthana Sutta, which is a very, very good book, one of the ways he talks about mindfulness, which I find brilliant, concise and clear, is as a middle way between suppressing our experience on the one hand and over-identifying with it on the other. And I think that's what we're doing in this stage. We sort of drop back. We're not suppressing and we're not over-identifying, but we're living our life in a very sort of real, rich, immediate way, but without these reactive tendencies. So I think that's a bit getting towards the experience of someone who's a bit wiser in terms of how they deal with the worldly winds.